In this video, we'll discuss about LeFort 1 osteotomy, orthognathic surgery. Okay, this is first reported by Von Langenbeck, but the current technique we are using are due to the effects of many scientists who modified the original technique by Langenbeck. So there are two main indications for LeFort 1 orthognathic surgery. They are orthognathic purpose, that is maxillary excess or maxillary deficiency in anteroposterior plane, that is maxillary proclination or retrusion, and vertical plane and transverse plane. So maxillary excess or deficiency in three planes, they can be modified by LeFort 1 orthognathic surgery. Then for non-orthognathic purpose, obstructive sleep apnea and for resection of cranial base tumors, that is tumors located in cranial base, maybe it is nasopharynx or maybe in the pterygopalatine fossa, like that. Tumors located in the cranial base, it provides access. So it can be used as a access surgery. So these are the main two indications, orthognathic purpose and non-orthognathic purpose. After that, coming to the surgical technique, this technique is done under general anesthesia. So these are the step by step procedure. The first step is LA infiltration, local anesthesia infiltration in the maxillary vestibule. After that, soft tissue incision. You can see here, this is the maxilla and this is the labial frenum. Okay, so this is all about labial and buccal maxillary vestibule. So incision is given in the maxillary vestibule 4 to 5 mm above the mucogingival junction. Okay, from one side first molar to another side first molar. Okay, you can see here, this is the first molar. Okay, so 4 to 5 mm above the mucogingival junction, from one side first molar to other side first molar. Okay, always start from the posterior end and move anteriorly. So in the midline, you can keep this incision as a V shape, so that we can detect the midline area when you are suturing, that is post procedural suturing. So the opposite side is also same, like this. Okay, this is the soft tissue incision for LeFort 1 osteotomy, and extend this incision and to the underlying bone. After soft tissue incision, you have to do subperiosteal dissection. This subperiosteal dissection can be divided into anterior dissection, superior lateral dissection and posterior dissection. That means after incising this, we have to elevate the mucoperiosteal flap. So first elevate the anterior part, that is in and around the piriform aperture. Elevate the nasal mucosa to expose the nasal floor. Okay, and elevate the around the piriform aperture to expose the or to access the piriform lateral walls. Okay, after that you have to elevate superior laterally, that means to expose the lateral wall of the maxilla and infraorbital nerve. And after that you are going to elevate on the posterior side, that means posterior maxillary exposure. You can see in this diagram, this is the access what we can gain after the subperiosteal dissection. Okay, this is the incision site. After that elevation, so this is the piriform aperture and this is the retractor placed in the place to retract the nasal mucosa. So this is the piriform aperture, that means this is the anterior dissection, and after that superior lateral dissection is to expose this lateral wall of the maxilla, and this is the infraorbital foramen. Okay, containing infraorbital nerve. After that we have to expose posteriorly, to expose the posterior wall of the maxilla. This is the posterior wall of the maxilla and this is the zygomaticomaxillary buttress. Okay, so subperiosteal dissection can be divided anterior, superior lateral and posterior dissection. This is the viewpoint you are going to get after elevation of the subperiosteal dissection. And after, next fourth step is marking osteotomy line and internal reference marks. Okay, first we have to design the osteotomy line. It is approximately designed 4 to 5 mm above the root apices. First detect the root apex of the canine. This is the canine. So say this is the root apex of the canine. 4 to 5 mm above the root apex, see how to design the osteotomy. So, say this. This is the design of the osteotomy. Lateral osteotomy. After designing this, we have to mark the internal reference point. One point above this line in the lateral orbit, lateral wall of piriform rim, and one point below this line. These reference points can be used as a guiding points after the repositioning of the maxilla. After we have completed the osteotomy and you are going to reposition the maxilla, these reference points can be used, especially in cases of superior positioning of the maxilla. So the fourth step is to design the osteotomy line and to mark the internal reference point. This osteotomy line should be generally, it is parallel to the maxillary occlusal plane. Okay, instead of using internal reference points, some doctors, some surgeons utilize external reference points also by fixing a K wire in the nasal bridge. That is, at the nasal point, they will fix a K wire and they will measure the difference between this K wire to the braces on the maxillary central incisors. So this can be utilized also. And internal reference points, you have to measure this distance between these two internal reference points. This is the fourth step. After that, maxillary lateral wall osteotomy. Okay, so now the osteotomy cut starts. With a rotating saw, or you can utilize the 702 or 703 surgical burrs with saline irrigation. Start posteriorly, approximately at the zygomaticomaxillary buttress, and move anteriorly with a rotating saw. First, you have to do the osteotomy cut in the maxillary lateral wall. That is, first osteotomy cut is maxillary lateral wall cut. That means this one. Okay, we will complete this. This is the osteotomy line in the lateral wall. After that, we have to prepare osteotomy line in the posterior wall. That means behind the maxillary tuberosity. So some others suggest that to prepare a vertical step and give the posterior cut. That means first we'll give a vertical step like this. Okay. After that, we have to prepare the posterior osteotomy like this. So this is the posterior wall osteotomy till the pterygomaxillary junction. Okay, till the pterygomaxillary junction, a posterior osteotomy. That means the vertical levels of this lateral wall osteotomy and posterior wall osteotomy are somewhat different. There is at least 2 to 3 mm difference. So these two wall osteotomies are connected by a vertical step like this. Okay, so this is the lateral wall osteotomy and posterior wall osteotomy. After that, you have to prepare lateral nasal wall osteotomy. That means you can see in this diagram. Okay, this is the already the cuts we have given, and with a osteotome, you are going to place this osteotome at the lateral nasal wall. That means this is the lateral nasal wall of the piriform aperture. You are placing it there, and the direction of this is posterior laterally, because you know that lateral wall, as it goes posteriorly, it flares somewhat laterally. Okay, so place it in the lateral wall of the nose and tap it till the depth of 25 to 30 mm, not more than that. If you are going deeper than that, then there are higher chances of injuring descending palatine artery. Okay, descending palatine artery. So this step should be done till the 25 to 30 mm depth with a osteotome placed in the lateral wall of the nose, and the direction of this osteotome is posterior laterally. Okay, we'll see this later. Okay, after that, lateral nasal wall osteotomy, the next step is pterygomaxillary disjunction. Okay, you can see in this diagram, this is the maxilla and this is the osteotomy cuts we have prepared already.
these are the osteotomy cuts we have prepared already. So this is the pterygoid plates, these are the pterygoid plates, this is the junction between the pterygoid plates and maxilla, that is called as pterygomaxillary junction. Okay, so by placing a curved osteotome at this place, it faces inferior medially. Okay, the direction of this osteotome is inferiorly and somewhat medially. Very much important, that direction can be asked in PG question. Okay, after placing like this, place the index finger of other hand from the palatal side at the approximately tuberosity region, so that you can feel the direction of cut. Okay, after that you are going to tap this osteotome to aid in the pterygomaxillary distension. This is the most important step of the Lefort 1 osteotomy. If the cut is incomplete in this area, then you will feel difficulty when you are down fracturing the maxilla. Okay, so this is the pterygomaxillary disjunction. Till now we have completed 8 steps of Lefort 1 osteotomy. We'll see further now. Next step is repeat the exact procedure on the opposite side. Okay, after that, nasal septum osteotomy. You can see in this diagram, this is the piriform aperture and these are the lateral nasal walls and this is the nasal septum. So we have already osteotomized lateral nasal walls. So now we have to take a nasal septal osteotome. There is specialized instrument for this nasal septal osteotome. Place it under the behind the anterior nasal spine. Okay, position it like posterior inferiorly. This direction of this instrument should be posterior inferiorly and tap on that, so that you can separate the nasal septum from the nasal floor. Okay, so this is the next 10th step. After that, down fracturing the maxilla. This is also one of the most important step in the Lefort 1 osteotomy. You can see in this diagram, place a gauze on anterior maxilla and with a thumb pressure on the anterior maxilla in downward direction, you can fracture the maxilla. Okay, in this is the maxillary rim and this is the gauze. Okay, these are the already osteotomized lines. Okay, this is the nasal floor. These are the nasal floor. So you are fracturing the maxilla with downward pressure. Once you fracture the maxilla, you will get the look like this. Okay, you can see here, this is the anterior nasal spine and this is the nasal septum. These are the nasal floor, okay, right and left. And after that, this is the lateral nasal wall. This is the lateral wall of the maxilla and this is the posterior wall of the maxilla. Okay, the other side same. So in this diagram, I will repeat the osteotomy lines again. First, what we have done, maxillary lateral wall osteotomy, that means osteotomizing this wall. Okay, this wall osteotomy. After that, posterior wall osteotomy, we have to osteotomize this wall. Okay, after that, this lateral nasal wall osteotomy, this one. Okay, and after that, we are going to repeat the procedure on this side. After that, we are going to osteotomize nasal septum, the middle one. Okay, after that, down fracturing the maxilla. You can see here, this is the descending palatine artery. Descending palatine artery, the most common artery which gets bleeds or which is injured during the Lefort 1 osteotomy is descending palatine artery. That is why when you are osteotomizing lateral nasal wall, you should extend till 25 to 30 mm only. Beyond that, there are increased chances of injury to the descending palatine artery, because the descending palatine artery is at a position of 34 mm. Okay, so this is the view you are going to get. After down fracturing, the next step is mobilization and bony projection removal. That means you have to completely mobilize the maxilla. You can use the disimpaction forceps or you can do it with the periosteal elevator. After complete mobilization of the maxilla, you are going to remove any sharp bony projections in the osteotomy lines, especially along the posterior wall of the maxilla. There are chances of sharp bony projections, you have to remove all those things. And when you are planning for superior positioning of the maxilla, you have to remove the some amount of bone along the lateral nasal wall also. Okay, by nibblers, bone nibblers or rongers also you can use. We have to remove the bone, and in superior positioning cases we have to modify the piriform rim also. In some cases you have to modify the piriform rim, and after all modifications you have to prepare a groove in the floor, nasal floor, for the positioning of the nasal septum. That means with a rotating vulcanite burr you have to prepare the groove here. Okay, this is the nasal septum, so you have to prepare a groove in this area, complete nasal septum area. Okay, this step is very much important to prevent the nasal septum deviation, because when you are posteriorly positioning the maxilla there are chances of deviation of nasal septum if you fail to prepare like this. Okay, so in this groove you are going to position the nasal septum. If necessary you can remove some amount of nasal cartilage also. Okay, nasal septal cartilage also you can remove that. So this is all about, the main important thing is you have to remove the bony projections. If there are bony projections, then the repositioning is difficult and there are chances of relapse and there are chances of postoperative bleeding also. Okay, and after that you have to keep the teeth under intermaxillary fixation. That means already you have a splint, preoperative splint prepared by the modal surgery on the cast. Okay, so keep that splint in between the teeth and do the intermaxillary fixation. You can see here, okay, maxilla and mandibular intermaxillary fixation is done, and after that you have to position the condyle within the glenoid fossa. This can be done by the application of digital pressure slightly anterior to the mandibular angle. Okay, like this, somewhat posterior upwards. First you have to do somewhat posterior movement and then upward to seat the condyle within the glenoid fossa. Okay, this is also one of the most important step. If you fail to do like this, if there is incorrect positioning of the condyle within the glenoid fossa, then there are high chances of malocclusion or otherwise relapse. Okay, after this step you are going to rotate. This is the osteotomy lines. Okay, so after that, after positioning condyle, you are going to rotate the maxillomandibular complex upwards to gain the bony contact with the superior bone, but superior midface intact bone. Okay, after gaining bony contact, if there is necessary for bone graft, you have to place the bone graft and you are going to fix the osteotomy lines. Fixing is also almost same as Lefort 1 fracture. Okay, first we have to fix along the lateral nasal wall, that is lateral wall of the piriform rim, and one plate at the zygomaticomaxillary buttress area. This is same as Lefort 1 fracture. Okay, you are reconstructing the vertical pillars of the midface, that is first one naso maxillary pillar and second one is zygomaticomaxillary buttress. You are reconstructing these two buttress. You can use L plates 1.5 mm, or you can use 2 mm plates also. Okay, this is the fixation method. After you fix the osteotomy segments, that means this is one side and another side also there are two plates, that means there are totally four plates we can use. Okay, after fixation you are going to suture the incision side. In suture there is something important called as ALR base cinching. Okay, we will discuss right now. Next is ALR base cinching. That means as we have dissected all the perinasal muscles or perinasal tissue, so there are chances of widening of the ALR base. That means nose becomes widened. Okay, to prevent that, this ALR base cinching is done. In this step we are going to grasp the nasalis muscle on the both sides. You can see in this diagram, this is the nasalis muscle. Okay, this is the nasalis muscle. So we are going to grasp these nasalis muscles with a suture, and we are going to tie these nasal muscles to the anterior nasal spine. You can see here, this is the anterior nasal spine. We are going to make a hole through the anterior nasal spine and we are going to pass these sutures through that hole and we are going to tie it. Okay, you can see these are the sutures. These are the sutures passed from the bilateral nasalis muscle. Okay, this is the hole made in the anterior nasal spine. So we are going to pass these sutures from this hole. Okay, and we are going to tie it. This is very much important step. Okay, if you fail to do this, there is widening of the alar base. Okay, after alar cinching, that is this one, the nasalis muscle is very much important. The name of the muscle can be asked as a PG question. So this prevents widening of the alar base. You can see in this, you can see in this diagram. Okay, it prevents widening. So because of that suture, there is constriction at the alar bases. If you fail to do, it will widen. Okay, after that we have to close the mucosa suturing. Next step is mucosal suturing. You can see this. In this, we should close in a VY fashion or inverted T fashion. Okay, inverted to a T fashion. That means we should identify the central mucosa, central papillary frenal region. Okay, and that should be closed in a VY suture manner because this prevents the shortening of the vestibule or shortening of the upper lip. Okay, so this is the mucosal suturing. And then the vascular basis for Lifot 1 osteotomy, that means the osteotomized segment gets its blood supply from the ascending palatine artery of facial artery and ascending pharyngeal branch of the external carotid artery. So these two names can be asked as a PG question, right? After that, the complications, bleeding, especially due to the injury of descending palatine artery. After that, widening of alar base, if you fail to do the alar base cinching, and non-union, okay, if your fixation is not sufficient enough rigid, then there is chances of non-union, and avascular necrosis. That means avascular necrosis is nothing but there is no blood supply to the osteotomized maxilla. Especially, you have to preserve the posterior palatal tissue pedicle. That means these ascending palatine arteries and ascending pharyngeal arteries run in the palatal soft tissue, palatal posterior soft tissue, especially in the soft palate region. So if you, when you are down fracturing the maxilla, if you injure that soft tissue pedicle, then it will result in compromised blood supply to the maxilla, leading to the avascular necrosis. Okay, this is all about Lifot 1 osteotomy. If you like this video, hit the like button, share the video, subscribe the channel.